हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू बायोलॉजी क्लास। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न वन मोर न्यू लेसन, लेसन नंबर 17, दैट इज रिप्रोडक्शन इन प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल्स। In this lesson, what are we going to learn? What are the learning objectives of this lesson? You will learn to differentiate the vegetative, asexual and sexual reproduction. And you will learn to describe the parts of a flower and their functions. You will understand the different types and modes of pollination and their significance. And you will also understand the process of double fertilization, steps involved in fertilization, that is syngamy and triple fusion, embryo development, endosperm development and the formation of the seed in this lesson. Now, reproduction in plants and animals introduction. All organisms have the ability to produce more of its own kind. And this is called reproduction. Every organism, from the microorganism like bacteria, protozoans, virus, to the large organism, very large organisms like very tall trees in the forest, are able to produce more of their own kind. And this process is called as reproduction. Why should the reproduction take place? So reproduction ensures the continuity and the survival of the species. So what God has created in this world, they are surviving till today because of the reproduction. And this process is to preserve the individuals, and this is called self-perpetuation. There are three types of reproduction in plants, namely vegetative reproduction, asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. First, we are going to learn about vegetative reproduction. New plantlets from the vegetative parts are formed in the vegetative reproduction, which are considered as the vegetative cells. The somatic cells are called as vegetative cells. The plant body has got two types of cells, vegetative as well as generative. Generative cells are present in the reproductive organs like flowers, whereas vegetative cells are present in the buds and other organs like root, leaf, stem and buds from these regions. And these buds, when they grow, they get detached from the plant and become individual plant, individual daughter plant, and they become a separate plant. So this happens only through the mitotic division. Here in the vegetative reproduction, there is no gamete fusion, gamete formation is absent, as well as no gametic fusion take place in the vegetative reproduction. So the daughter plants are genetically identical among themselves as well as to their parents. So these vegetative reproduction can take place, once again I tell you, takes place through the leaves, example bryophyllum, through the stem like in strawberry, roots like sweet potato and bulbils. Vegetative reproduction through leaves. So this is the picture of a bryophyllum plant. On the leaf margin there are small notches, and from these notches new leaves and buds will arise, and these buds will get detach itself from the parent plant and they will fall down and become new individual. And this bryophyllum plant in Tamil we call as katti potal kutti podum. This is the reproduction through the leaves. Next is the vegetative reproduction through stem. For this example is strawberry plant. Here The weak stem that grows will touch the ground and gives off adventitious roots like this. And at the bottom down, it will give to the towards the ground, it will give the roots, and towards the top it will develop the aerial buds. And when this plant grow to enough size, so the connection can be cut off from the parent plant, it can be broken, and this offspring can become an independent plant. The next vegetative propagation method is present in the root, that is tuberous root, example asparagus and sweet potato. The eye-like structure in the tuberous root, the storage root in the asparagus and the sweet potato, can be used for the vegetative propagation. The next is bulbils. So bulbils are nothing but, in some plants, the flower buds are modified into globose bulb-like structure, and this will contain bulbils. So bulbils, when they grow and mature, they will shed off from their plant, they fall on the ground, and they can grow into new plants. Example for this is agave. Next, we shall see the other types of vegetative reproduction. That is, first one is fragmentation. Example for fragmentation, Spirogyra. So we all well know that Spirogyra is a filamentous algae. So filamentous algae, the cells are arranged in linear manner, one above the other. So when the algae mature, so there will be a break off in the filaments like this, and they will leave off these small pieces, and these pieces will develop into new individual plant, and this is what happens in the case of fragmentation in Spirogyra. Next one is called as fission in amoeba. So amoeba reproduction we have already learned. So amoeba reproduce by simple fission, binary fission, multiple fission, etc. So fission, what happens is when the amoeba matures, the nucleus and the cytoplasm will elongate like this, making a constriction in between, which will divide the cell into two daughter cells. So this is how the amoeba will reproduce vegetatively. The next one is called budding. So budding example is yeast. So this is a parent yeast cell. So yeast cell will develop new cells as buds like this, and at certain stage these buds will get detached from the parent cell and they will develop into a new individual. Type is called as regeneration. Example for regeneration, Hydra and Planaria. So here in this organism, if they lose their body parts, it can be newly grown, it can be fully grown. The ability of the last parts of these individual organism to give rise to a whole new organism is called as regeneration. And this takes place by the replacement of a specialized mass of cells in Hydra and Planaria. Going to see the second type of reproduction, that is asexual reproduction. Here, one parent is enough for producing the offspring. There is no need for two parents. And one parent, the production of offspring can take place by a single parent. And it happens without the formation of the gamete and the fusion of gametes. The individuals are produced without any gamete formation or gamete fusion. And so there is no meiosis, only mitosis take place. The offspring produced out of this method are identical to each other as well as to their parents. Asexual reproduction normally occurs by spore formation. And this is the most common method of asexual reproduction in fungi and bacteria. During the spore formation, the hyphae of the fungi, this is the hyphae of the fungi, that will develop a structure called sporangium. This is a fungal hyphae which will develop a structure called sporangium. And the sporangium will have the nucleus, and this nucleus will divide several times within the sporangium, and each nucleus will be encircled by a small amount of cytoplasm to develop into spores. and these spores are liberated after maturation. When they fall on a suitable substratum, they will germinate and develop the new hyphae mycelium. And this is how the fungus reproduce, by forming spores. Third method of reproduction in plant is sexual reproduction. Here the male and the female gametes, which are produced by the individuals, will fuse to produce the young one. And so the gametes are produced by the reduction, division or meiosis. And these gametes contain the genetic material or genes on the chromosomes. This will transmit the characteristic features or the traits to the next generation. The plants reproduce through the reproductive organ called flower. Let us learn the structure of a typical flower to understand the sexual reproduction better. What is a flower? A flower is a modified shoot with limited growth to carry out the reproduction, sexual reproduction. A flower consists of four whorls, namely calyx, corolla, andrecium and gynoecium. So calyx consists of the green color sepals, whereas corolla consists of the colorful petals. Andrecium, this is the yellow color structure, is called andrecium, which consists of the stamens, which will have the male gamete. Whereas the green color structure, which is called as the gynoecium or pistil, consists of the carpels. So there are two outermost whorls. The calyx and the corolla are called as non-essential or accessory whorls, whereas the andrecium and gynoecium are called as essential whorls. Why? Because these two, the calyx and corolla, they do not take part in the reproduction directly, whereas the andrecium and gynoecium take part in the reproduction directly, and so they are termed as essential whorls. Let us learn about the andrecium. Andrecium is the male part of the flower and it consists of stamen. And stamen has two components, a stalk-like structure called filament and a bag-like structure called anther. The anther contains the pollen sac, and within the pollen sac, the pollen grains are produced. And this is the structure of the andrecium. Now let us learn what are pollen grains. The pollen grains are produced by the anther in the pollen sac. And the pollen grains are usually spherical in shape, and it will have two walls. The outermost wall is called the exine and it is harder, whereas the inner wall is called as intine. The exine is discontinuous and it will have certain gaps or apertures called germ pore, whereas the inner wall is continuous and it is made up of cellulose and pectin. A mature pollen grain will contain two cells, a vegetative cell and a generative cell. The vegetative cell, the nucleus will be larger, and the generative cell will divide mitotically into two male gametes. Learn the structure of gynoecium. This is the gynoecium of the flower, and it is the female part of the flower, which is made up of carpels. It consists of three parts, namely ovary, the bottommost part is called ovary, continued as a stalk-like style, and it ends with the stigma, which is sticky. The ovary will contain the ovules in it and they become the seeds. Now let us learn the structure of ovule. This is the ovule. The main part of the ovule is nucellus. Here it is. And this nucellus is enclosed by two integument, leaving a opening called as micropyle. And the ovule is attached to the ovary wall by a stalk called as funiculus. The part which is opposite to this micropyle is called as chalaza, and this forms the basal part. This is the embryo sac. The new cells consist of embryo sac, and this embryo sac contains 7 cells and 8 nuclei. Three cells are present in the micropylar end, which is consist of the egg apparatus. In the egg apparatus, the center cell is called as the egg cell. The remaining 2 cells are called synergids. And the other 3 cells, which is at the opposite end, near the chalazal end, they are called as antipodal cells. The 2 center nuclei are called as polar nuclei. This is the structure of the ovule. The process of sexual reproduction in flowering plant involves pollination and fertilization. Now let us see what is pollination first. What is pollination? Pollination is the transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma of the flower. So pollination is very important, because only after pollination fertilization can take place, and fertilization only leads to the formation of the fruits and seeds. So the importance of pollination are formation of the fruits and seeds from the flower. Then this pollination also helps in the formation of new varieties of plants through the combination of different genes in case of the cross-pollination. Now let us see the types of pollination. There are 2 types of pollination, namely self-pollination, which is otherwise called autogamy, and cross-pollination, which is called as allogamy. Now let us learn first the self-pollination. Self-pollination is called as autogamy. Example for it is hibiscus. Define self-pollination. Self-pollination can be defined as the transfer of pollen from anther to stigma of the same flower or another flower which is born on the same plant. So this is what is called as self-pollination. Now, what are the advantages of autogamy or self-pollination? So, self-pollination can take place only in the bisexual flowers. The flower should have both andrecium and gynoecium. Then only the self-pollination can take place. So, most of the bisexual flower pollinate through the self-pollination. Then flowers do not depend on any external agent, because self-pollination takes place within the flower, and so they do not depend on any external agents for their pollination. And the third point is that there is no wastage of pollen grains in the self-pollination. There are also certain disadvantages in the self-pollination. So what are the disadvantages of the self-pollination? So when the plants are reproducing by self-pollination, the seeds that are produced will be very less in number. The seeds are less in number in case of self-pollination. And the endosperm is also minute. What is endosperm? This is nothing but the nutritive tissue that will give the nutrition for the developing embryo inside the seed. And this endosperm will be minute in the case of self-pollinating flowers. And therefore, they produce weak plants. And there is no formation of any new varieties in this self-pollination. No new varieties of plants are produced. Let us learn what is cross-pollination. Cross-pollination is nothing but the transfer of pollen grains of a flower from the anther to the stigma of a flower which is in another plant of the same species. I repeat. Cross-pollination is transfer of pollen grains from the anther of a flower to the stigma of a flower which is in another plant of the same species. Example is apple, grapes, plum, etc. Now, what are the advantages of cross-pollination? Cross-pollination produces seeds which will develop and germinate properly and grow into a better plants. And so the seeds which are produced out of cross-pollination can produce a better plant. That means the cross-pollination give rise to new plants, new varieties of plants, which is advantageous. And they also produce more viable seeds. Cross-pollination produce viable seeds. All the seeds will be very much efficient to produce new individual plants. What are the disadvantages of cross-pollination? Pollination may fail sometime because of the distance barrier. If the plants are separated from each other for a long distance, the agents may not be that much efficient to carry the pollen from one plant to another plant. And so here, distance become a barrier for pollination and the pollination may fail. And there is also more wastage of pollen grains in the case of cross-pollination. And it may also sometimes introduce unwanted characters in the plant, because which pollen grain is pollinating a particular flower, it's unknown, and sometimes it may also bring about some unwanted characters in the plants which are produced newly. And they have to depend on the external agents for the pollination. If the external agents are not available, then the pollination does not take place. And so flowers depend on the external agents for the pollination, which is a drawback. On the agents of pollination. So in order to bring about the cross-pollination, it is necessary for the pollen grains to be carried from one flower to another flower of a different plant. And this takes place through the agencies like animals, insects, wind and water. Let us learn one by one. The pollination that takes place by wind is called as anemophily. And the anemophilous flowers must produce enormous amount of pollen grains, because large amount of them is wasted when they are carried from one place to another. And the pollen grains must be of small size. They must be smooth, dry and lightweight, so that they can be easily carried by the wind. The pollen of such plants can be blown off to a distance of about 1000 kilometers and more than that. The stigmas are comparatively large and it must be hairy and protruding out of the flower to trap the flying pollen grains in the wind. Example of it is grasses and cacti. Cacti or cactus are the desert plants. Now pollination by insects, it's said to be entomophily. And here the flowers must be bright colored, good smell it should have, and nectar also must be present in the flower. So then only many insects will be visiting the flowers for the smell, nectar and the bright color. And the pollen which are produced must be large, and the exine of the pollen must be pitted. Pitted means there must be hole or apertures on it, and it must be spiny also. So 80% of the entomophily takes place with the help of the bees. Now pollination by water. Pollination by water is called as hydrophily, and this takes place in the aquatic plants. Here also the pollen grains must be produced in large numbers, and the pollen must float till they land on the stigma of the flower. And this happens in the case of Vallisneria, which is the water plant. The pollen grains will float, they will detach themselves from the flower and they will come and float on the water surface till they land on the stigma of the flower in case of Vallisneria. The next one is pollination by animals. The pollination that takes place with the help of animal is said to be zoophily. And here also the flowers must be of bright colored, large size, and it must be centered to attract the animals. Example for it is sunbird pollinates the plants like canna and gladioli, etc. So canna is chevvare, which will have a large brightly colored flower. And squirrels will help in the pollination of silk cotton trees. On the fertilization in plants, or the process of fertilization. And this is the diagram of the ovule during fertilization. The pollen grains reaches the stigma. These are the pollen grains and stigma. They reach the stigma and they begin to germinate. The pollen grain form a small tubular structures which is called as pollen tube, and that will emerge out of the germ pore. You know what are germ pores? Germ pores are the apertures which are present on the exside of the pollen grain. And the content of the pollen grain move into the tube. The pollen tube grows through the tissues of the stigma and the style, and finally it reaches the micropylar end of the ovule. And this here, it will have, the pollen tube will have two cells, the vegetative cell and the generative cells, as we have learned in the structure of pollen grains. When the pollen tube reaches the micropylar end, the vegetative cell will degenerate and the generative cell will divide it to form two sperm cells, and they are called as male gametes. The tip of the pollen tube will burst, releasing the two sperms to enter into the embryo sac of the ovule. And one sperm will fuse with the egg. You know, where is the egg present? Egg present in the egg apparatus, in between the synergids. And one sperm will fuse with the egg, and this process is called syngamy. Fusion of the sperm nucleus with the egg is called a syngamy, and it forms a diploid zygote. And this zygote will develop into the embryo. The one more sperm will fuse with the secondary nucleus. What is called secondary nucleus? We said the two polar nuclei which is present in the center forms a secondary nucleus. Second male gamete will fuse with this secondary nucleus, and this is called as triple fusion to form the primary endosperm nucleus. This is triploid in nature. Why? Because it has got two nuclei. We have learned already the polar nuclei are two in number, and one more fusion of one more male gamete makes it 3N, and so this is triploid in nature. Since two types of fusion take place, like syngamy and triple fusion, in the embryo the process is said to be called as double fertilization. I repeat, one male gamete will fuse with the egg apparatus, which is called syngamy, to form the diploid zygote. The other sperm will fuse with the secondary nucleus. This is called triple fusion. This will form the endosperm. And this is triploid in nature. It will have 3N. So since two types of fusion, syngamy as well as the triple fusion, take place in the embryo, the process is said to be, is termed as double fertilization. So after this triple fusion, the primary endosperm nucleus will develop into the endosperm. This endosperm only will provide the food for the developing embryo in the seed. So the synergids and antipodal cells and all will degenerate afterwards. Now let us learn the significance of fertilization. So what are the significance of fertilization? Fertilization only stimulates the ovary to develop into fruit. Otherwise, it will just die off. So once the fertilization takes place, it will stimulate the ovary to develop into a fruit. And it also helps in the development of the new characters, because two different cells are combining here. The pollen grains will bring the different genetic constitution in it, male gamete, as well as the egg will have one constitution, gene constitution, and so development of new characters can be attained. So it helps in the development of new characters from the different individuals. So fertilization, these are the significance of fertilization. What are the post-fertilization changes? The ovule will develop into seed. So after fertilization, the ovule will develop into seed, which will have the embryo inside, and that when it is planted on a suitable land substratum, that will germinate and produce the new plant. The integuments of the ovule will develop into the seed coat, and the ovary enlarges and develops into a fruit. So seeds will be present inside the fruit, and that will hold the embryo, which will develop into seedling under appropriate conditions.